2 years after the U.S. Constitution was signed, debt-free money was tried in Sweden in 1789, but with tragic results. To pursue a war with Russia, King Gustav III persuaded the Swedish Parliament to print debt-free money called Riksgald. This was very costly to the bankers. Sweden had learned the secret of simply printing its own money without debt. In 1792, only 3 years into the experiment, King Gustav was assassinated by moneylender Jacob Johann Ankerström. As is frequently the case in time of war, too many Riksgalds were printed. The quantity was not controlled. A nation will sacrifice everything for survival during time of war. So, inflation ruined the debt-free money experiment in Sweden by 1834, just as it had a few years earlier during the American Revolution, again because the quantity was not controlled.
Interestingly, the Bank of North Dakota idea was initiated by a group of Swedish immigrants to North Dakota in the early 1900s. Community banking had been going on in Sweden for at least a century before that. Around 1820, the Swedes came up with the idea of the savings bank.
These full reserve banks only lent out money they actually had. They decentralized the money power and were encouraged by the government as a way for municipalities to fight poverty.
These operated on what was known as the church steeple principle, where the bank could only make loans to customers whose houses could be seen from the highest church steeple in town.
These community banks increased the common wealth instead of the big bankers' wealth. This helped Sweden grow rich, which helped Stockholm
to grow into the magnificent Venice of Scandinavia that we see here today. But then the debt-based bankers attacked the savings banks.
They first convinced most of them to consolidate into bigger and bigger banks. Then the Swedish Parliament was convinced to pass a law allowing the non-profit savings banks to be bought up by the commercial banks. After a series of mergers, these banks are now called Swedbank. For the most part, this ended Sweden's proud 200-year history of public banking.
They were under a severe attack during the 80s, but many of the saving banks still remain in the country. And they are very effective, and especially because they decentralize the power and give it back into the hands of the citizens. They empower the local communities. And in times of crisis, they have proven to be more profitable than the big banks.
Now there are only about 50 savings banks left in Sweden.
A small remnant of a great idea for decentralized banking that shows that cities, towns, or even nations
can operate entirely debt-free.